This is Patrick
and Svea
from Guy in a Cube, and in this video we're going to introduce the world to Azure Data Explorer, but more importantly we're going to tell you what it is and when you should use it. Stay tuned. If you find this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date from all the videos from both Adam and this guy. All right, Svea, thank you so much for joining me to talk about Azure Data Explorer. Why don't you do a quick introduction, tell the people who you are, where you're from, that type of stuff.
So first, I would like to tell you that I'm super excited. You are like a superstar in my world of data.
Wow. Making me blush.
Yeah, you should. And I'm a principal PM manager at Azure Data Explorer. And today I'm here to share with you one of the magical capabilities of Azure, but it's also one of the most kept secrets of Azure, which is Azure Data Explorer.
So, Svea, I've done a little work with Azure Data Explorer. I don't claim to be an expert, but I'm starting to like it, and I'm gonna start using it more and more. From the documentation and everything I read, it said telemetry data is perfect for Azure Data Explorer. Time-based data is perfect for Azure Data Explorer. But if you're here with us, my guess is that Azure Data Explorer is so much more.
Yes, it's great for those scenarios, definitely. But it's so much more. ADX is built to support streaming data analytics scenarios like operational and development logs, IoT events, human logs, customer service, chat, free text, financial data, marketing clickstream data. ADX support data size from gigabytes to terabytes, and we even have customers with petabytes of information.
Petabytes.
The latency from ingestion to query is less than a couple of seconds.
Wow.
And you can query up to billions of records in a second.
Wow.
It supports different formats, sources, structure, data that is structured, semi-structured like JSON, HTML, arrays, and also free text is fully supported to optimize queries.
So now that we know what it is and all the different use cases, I think it's time to see it. So you guys know how we like to do over here at Guy in a Cube. Instead of all this talking, let's head over to Svea's laptop.
Welcome to Azure Web Explorer, which is one of the many options to explore Azure data information. In this demo, I will start with Power BI tracing.
Okay.
Power BI sends all the traces into Azure Data Explorer databases. Here, for example, we took a sample of some information, 5 tables with 41 terabytes of data. Come down to 3.6 terabytes of information.
I think you're a mind reader, Svea, because I saw one table that was 24 terabytes, but it was compressed down to, I forget the number, but it was just a fraction of what it was. How? Why is this important?
First of all, it's part of the ingestion part. We compress the data and ingest it into the different charts. And it's super important because the actual database size, it will be per the compressed size and not the original size. In this example, with 90% less than the actual size, which also affects your billing at the end of the month.
So not only do I have a small amount of data, but I also save money?
Yeah, it's not smaller amount of data, it's just compressed in
right.
a very efficient way.
Right.
Save you a lot of information.
Okay, so this is a lot of data. Can Azure Data Explorer query this data fast? How does it perform?
Let me show you. I am taking the 24 terabytes of data, which is the Power BI Azure Trace table, and I run it to see that there are 40.9 billions of records. And now let's see that some sample of the data in this table. So I can see that there is some structured data of date and type and level. But here at the end, I also have the original log text as a free text. Keep it in mind, Patrick, don't forget about it.
Okay.
Now I will take 1 day of activity, 800 million of records, and I would like to present the distribution of those errors during the day.
Wow.
And here you can see that there are plenty of errors, but it's pretty stable, and here and there are some hiccups. The next thing is to find the 10 most frustrated users that has the highest number of errors and suffer the most in those scenarios.
Svea, let me ask you a question. You're running these queries over 40 billion rows of data, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
40 and 90.
Okay.
I just want to be very precise about that.
Okay, all right.
I'm taking this table and I'm going to search for the most frustrated users. I am building two in-memory views. The first one is the user IDs. Patrick, do you remember the event text, the free text that we saw earlier? So now I take this and I look for a pattern that includes users, and I will extract it into a temporary column in my temporary user ID views. The other in-memory view is all the activities with error level 2. I'm going to join between these tables, sort it, and retrieve the top 10 customers that has the highest number of errors. Now, I have a question for you. How long it will take me to run this query?
40 billion rows, sorting, parsing, you know, temporary tables, all those things. I'm gonna guess, since you're here, you know, bragging a little bit, I'm gonna guess about 10 seconds.
Wow, you're ambitious. Let me try. Okay, hold your breath. And that's it. 1.8 seconds. And to be more precise, about 4 gigabytes of information. And the actual runtime was less than 1.6.
Three things that we need to talk about. So first, the language that you're seeing, it's called KQL. I'm gonna do a video on writing your first KQL statement and post some resources in the comments below so you can help get familiar with KQL. I'll take care of that part. The next thing is, how is it that fast?
There is magic behind that. As part of the ingestion part, while the data is ingested into the service, we already compressed it. Per data type, we add indexes and divide it into the different shards and instances to optimize the query afterwards. We build a system in advance to support those type of analytics on big data.
That's amazing. It's so fast over all that data, but I'm sure there's something else you want to show us.
Are you familiar with Git?
Yeah, version control. I store a lot of stuff up there. Absolutely.
Okay, we collected a couple of years of public repos activities from 2016 to 2019.
Okay.
Overall of 1.6 billion of records. We store it in a table that includes structured data and also dynamics. Let's see, we take a sample of the information and you can see here that the dynamics include JSON data. Patrick, I'm sure that you would like to know what is the importance of dynamics column.
You know I do.
Dynamic columns allow us to build dynamics system.
Okay.
We can change the data structure. We can bring data from different sources in different structure, in different formats, into one table without the need to change the infrastructure. We can just bring it on and query it after. It gives you flexibility, awesome flexibility, to build a scale system.
So if I can add new columns and new attributes and change data and stuff like that, but it just handles it automatically.
Exactly, into those dynamics columns. And later, let me show you, I have those dynamics columns and I can run queries that allow me to query side by side the whole column as a string, but a specific attribute and specific value. And I can run it at the result set and I can return it as a query operator. And here you can see how can I look for a specific string inside the attribute and in the entire column.
Wow.
I will share with you what were the most popular repos between 2016 to 2019. I took all the repos that we checked, we gave that a weight of the watch time and the issues itself, and we have created a query that ran on top of everything and will present us the most popular repos in those years.
That is insane. So I have performance, 40 billion rows of data. It's super fast. I can take structured, unstructured data, dynamic columns. I can do all of this stuff using Azure Data Explorer.
Also free text.
Also free text. Svia, I'm gonna give this the insane, amazing tag. And I guarantee you, Svia's coming back to do another video because there's another thing we're gonna talk about. But before we go, there's one more thing. I was on LinkedIn and I saw you post that I can go out and get my own free cluster. Is that true?
Actually, it's available for the past half a year.
Oh.
That you, with any Microsoft account, can connect into dataexplorer.azure.com and get a free cluster for your own use. If you want to control your smart house, financial traffic, everything in work for your personal purposes, academical purposes, just use it. And fresh from the oven from this week, we also have the ability to upgrade as it is into a real production environment.
Wow. Wow. And all for free. So what we're going to do is we're going to post a link to this in the description below. So everybody should go run and check this out. I know I am. All right. What do you guys think? You got any questions? You got any comments? Would you like to take a deeper dive into anything that Svea and I have talked about? We'd love to know. Let's continue the conversation. Where? In the comments below. If it's your first time visiting the Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. You like my video? Two big thumbs up. As always, from Adam
to Svea
and myself, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.